Hey beautiful people on YouTube, hope you're doing well and keeping safe. This is Melbourne Yathri here from Melbourne, Victoria, Australia. This is our episode 3 of new house construction. In this phase, we basically cover the prerequisites for the site construction to start up to the initial phase of site construction. There are time codes displayed below in the description of the video. You can go ahead and jump to your favorite section and listen to it. Now, as we have seen in the earlier episode, the land cleaning has actually finished. Now, before we enter into the site construction phase, there are some prerequisites to be met. And these prerequisites do not have a particular order, but the order in which they would go would depend on the builder that you're actually hiring and how they try to do it. I've just covered most of the topics up here. If you want me to cover any of the topics in detail, I'm happy to go ahead and do them. The first things to have in order is the funding for construction phase. I'm guessing, if you have already taken a housing mortgage loan to purchase the land, the same banking company or the other banking company with the help of your licensed mortgage broker or your banking lending agent, you could arrange, the finance to fund the construction process also. If you want to know more about this, please do let me know. There is slightly change with respect to, funding for construction vis-a-vis funding for land. Then you need to have a clean land. As explained earlier, you need to get rid of all the rubbish and grass which is there on the land. By this time, you would have already finished a survey and also a site soil report. You need these two to actually finish the house design with the builder that you have chosen. So I'm guessing this is already done and you know the type of soil you're in. You're building on. The type of soil we are building on is actually a P-class soil. That's because, there has been a huge land, fill, which was done in our area because it's a hilly area and, there was a cut and fill done by the developer at the time. And hence it is classified as P. But then based on the movement of actually the sand of the soil, based on the report, we are actually designed for an M-class slab. But we'll be actually having piers below because, the soil is moving. If you want me to go through detail on a soil report and what is mentioned in the soil report and what is our, or very specifically, our interpretation of it, I could go ahead and do a separate video. Please do put it down in the comments. Then the other things you got to sort out is actually planning permits and building permits. And the building permits also include, council approved plans. Now, these are usually taken care of by your builder most of the times. As long as the builder is a HI registered builder, I don't think they'll have a larger issues in handling it. But I think some builders would prefer you to handle the planning permits and building permits. So you have to go ahead and actually, have this discussion with the builder to see, who is going to get it and what is the cost of getting it and what documents that you need to specifically submit to get these actually, permits done with your local council. Now, don't feel shy to go ahead and talk to your builder all about it. I mean, they're professional people. They know these things actually keep coming up site to site, purely dependent on site to site where you're building and which, suburb or council you're building. So go ahead and have the chat. Then the other thing you got to look for is basically if you're, as part of your construction, if you're doing any building over easements, so you have to go back and check with your council. First of all, is it allowed to be built over easements or not? Many councils don't, agree for it. So you have to go back and actually check with them. And the councils which do agree, they have very, very strict guidelines to follow if you're building over easement. And hence you have to, submit plans which would actually comply to the council's requirement to build over easements or adjacent to the easement. Then the other thing is, based on your front set out, that means what I mean by front set out is the distance from where your actually porch is or your garage is to where, the road actually starts or the walkway starts, okay, or the starting of your site, that front set out. Every council have their own requirements. You're supposed to check with your council or you can ask your builder or, if you're having an architect designing your home, then you can actually have them to go ahead and check with the council to see, what is the distance. Now, if your house, because of the way you're actually building it, comes overlaps with that distance, so there is up to a certain limit that the council would actually agree for you to overlap and come forward towards the road. And when you do that, you launch something called as a dispensation application and you pay a fee for it called as dispensation fee. Now, that is only needed if required, otherwise it's not needed. So you got to check with either your builder or architect, first of all, whether you know your, you know, is there any overlap? And then you can check with your council with respect to rules for dispensation and, you know, what is the front set out actually available in the area that you're trying to build. Okay. Now, for us, we did have to take a dispensation, approval, and we had to pay dispensation fee, as well as, you know, we had to take building over easements. We did not do a build over easement, but, you know, one of the footings was actually coming closer to the easement. And there is a site, you know, what you call the cut and fill was actually happening over the easement. And hence we had to go ahead and take permit, and we submitted all the plans necessary as per the council's requirement. Now, apart from this, most of the builders, you know, would actually ask an access to the block, a very clear access to the block. That means there should be proper roads above there, availability of power, availability of sewage, and availability of stormwater drain. Now, normally, if you have gone ahead and taken, you know, blocks in a very, very new area, newly developed area or yet to be developed area or slowly developing area, then, you know, you got to check for all this. If it's already a developed area, you know, the developer would have already had all of these. So normally the developer is supposed to provide, you know, all of these facilities, that is clear access to your block for you and your builders to go ahead and do the job. You know, availability of power, sewage, and stormwater drains are supposed to be given by the developer who's selling you the land. Now, apart from this, you know, once you have all of this, you know, in aligned up there, then you need to ensure that you have a HIA, you know, standard plain English contract signed between you and the builder. You know, the builder is supposed to give you an insurance. If I'm not wrong, that's called a builder's building insurance or something. I'm sorry, you know, I need to figure out the exact name, but if anyone of you know the name, please do drop down in the comments. And then once you actually sign the contract, and if you're actually, you know, taking a bank loan for funding your construction, then you need to go back and submit your HIA signed contract from you and the builder. Both need to sign that to the bank or the mortgage agent. Licensed mortgage agent, and they will actually then, you know, get a letter from the bank saying that the bank confirms the readiness to disperse the loan, the construction loan, provided the, you know, the milestones are met by the construction company or basically your builder. Now we are actually approaching the exciting bit of it. That's where, you know, your actual you will see your bare block of land turning into your dream home that you have been dreaming and building and designing all this time with the help of your builder and your builder's architects. So what happens out there is, the first thing is, you're going to have a re-establishment site survey. And in your re-establishment site survey is going to be separate from the site survey that you have done at the starting, before your home design has actually started. Okay. And in your re-establishment site survey, what they do is, you actually have a surveying company that comes up, it does a bunch of surveying, and what I've finally seen them do is to actually place pegs in the four corners of my home and say, okay, this is your actual boundary based on the layouts given by the council. Okay, now these guys are very, very precise. They get their precise equipment to do it. Most of the times the builders arrange for it. There are very few builders will ever ask you to go ahead and arrange it by yourself. If you want, you can. But, you know, in my personal opinion and in my experience, it's preferable if builder actually hires this re-establishment site survey people and get the job done. You know, the life is much more simpler using that. So if you see the images up here, so this is actually, you see the white, you know, square block kind of thing. So which is actually having a white spray on it. That is the actual peg, which is grounded into the, you know, which is basically put into the ground. And then you have a small stick around it with a pink ribbon. I mean, my particular, you know, site surveyor used a pink ribbon. I mean, your site surveyor could use any other color of choice, but, you know, that pole actually denotes that, you know, that's the corner of your home. Now, in areas, we are actually having fencing. Like, I am actually having fencing on three sides of my block. So, they'll actually go ahead and, you know, put a nail along with the pink ribbon on it, saying that, okay, this is the corner or this is where it actually ends. Okay, so this is with respect to re-establishment site survey. Now, once this actually finishes, you will see typically the builder coming up with, you know, their advertisement billboard. So most of the builders would love to use this opportunity of building on your site as an advertisement for themselves. Each builder has their own way of trying to advertise it. They have their own sizes, and the same builder might not use the same kind of a billboard at multiple other locations. It's dependent between what the builder and the builder's marketing or construction team thinks is the right advertisement in on your block of land. But generally, you would see, the builder would go ahead and put it. Now, this is the most exciting time. This is when you actually see something happening on your site, apart from just, grass growing and you're cutting the grass, or you're actually asking someone else to cut the grass for you and cleaning it up, all the mess there. So, yeah, I mean, I was very, very excited when this actually happened. Now, once this actually went ahead, the advertisement billboard, within the next couple of days, we have seen a portable toilet actually come up there, as well as temporary fence being come up out there. So this basically says that, the site supervisor has taken over the file. Or this is at least what I was explained, to me by, Henley, and please don't get me wrong if I understood the process in a different way. But my understanding is the site supervisor, the site construction team has actually received the file. They've gone through everything. They understand clearly what needs to be built, all your inclusions and different kind of, quirks that you want inside your home and all your customizations. So hence they've gone ahead and put, a temporary fence across, as you can see. And then they'll actually have a portable toilet put up out there, and that's specifically for the tradies to go and use. And then yes, they'll also have a temporary waste bin put up out there, so that whatever is the building waste which is being generated is being put up out there, and that waste bin is cleared time to time. They would get skip bins, and the skip bins will get loaded from these site-based waste bins into it. Now, the next phase would be actually site marking. So there would be someone who would come and mark it out for the cut and fill. And that's where, the most exciting part happens. This is where, groundbreaking actually happens for your home. So, if any one of you is actually religious, or, you want to go ahead and spend some time out there and take some pictures, this is the time. Because once the ground breaks, your block is not going to look the same at all forever in its life. Okay, so that's where it is. So moving on. Apart from, cut and fill, the other activities that would be done part of this base phase are actually, building retaining walls. This is specifically needed if you're having slope blocks. So they will be building retaining walls before, most of the construction actually starts. So I will be making a specific video for retaining walls, and that's actually in the next episode. There is a site set out done, and the site set out is typically, to put the exact or plot the exact, dimensions of your home on your block. Okay, and there is some specific videos done by, highly technical people who are into the construction industry. I'll give you links to it in my next episode, and you can see about it. Then there is pier boring and pouring, and this is very specific if your house actually need piers. So the requirement for piers is determined by the site engineer or the structural engineer who is going to design your slab, and they will go ahead and say, whether you need piers or not based on the soil report. So because I was having a P-class soil, and based on the movements which are there, I could get an M-class slab. So the engineer actually has decided that I need piers. We will be discussing much more in detail with respect to piers boring, pouring, and the number of piers that were designed for my home, for the slab on the home, in the upcoming videos. And then moving on, you will also have underground power. If you're having underground power in the area you're having, if you're having overhead power in the suburb where you're building, then you'd get overhead power. Then you obviously have underground drain that is being done. And underground drain, is especially the phase where all the, sewage as well as toilet and water, piping is actually done across. Now, my slab is actually, waffle pot slab. And now, since it's a waffle plot slab, most of, my plumbing work, which is actually underground plumbing work, will be finished in this particular phase. And the next phase is actually slab preparation and slab pour. As part of this episode, we would be discussing about cut and fill. retaining walls and set out is actually put up for our next episode. Now, most of the times you are supposed to be given, you know, a cut and fill diagram, which might look something similar like this. It's a much more larger diagram that I've just focused on this particular area, because as you can see the numbers on the screen, you would be seeing them in a particular sequence. They would be either increasing or decreasing sequence, and that predominantly is because of the way your land is being sloped. The way my land is actually set up, or my piece of block, is where the road is actually at the highest point and the backyard in my home is actually the lowest point. So it's sloping away from the road. Okay, so since it's sloping away from the road, you can see, you know, it's a descending order of numbers. So the highest number I'm having is 99.6 on the right side of the screen. And if you can see, then it goes, you know, a little bit below than 97.6. So that's a fair drop. And this is basically drops in mm. And this levels are actually bought out from the site survey that was done initially along with your soil report. You know, that's the stage that they come to know about these, you know, levels of slope in the land. And here, if you can see, right, based on the sloping, the structure engineer would decide the right level where they're supposed to cut and where they're supposed to fill. Now, if you see, you know, my cut line is around 99. So wherever the line 99 is, it's all relative numbers from there. So if you see to the right hand side, so they're actually cutting close to around 500 to 600 mm. And then they're actually filling the rest, which is close to what? 1.4 meters, I think, you know, 1400 mm is where I'm actually going to have fill on my site. So that's a pretty good slope of 1.4 meters or 1400 mm, either way you want to look at. And I have a cut of close to 500 mm because that's how the block is being sloped across. Okay, now the reason why they would do, you know, cut and fill is basically since I'm having a waffle plot slab and they would like to have a straight slab, that means we haven't opted for our home to be built at two different levels. We preferred it to be it completely as a flat level, and this is predominantly because of our personal choice, and hence, you know, there is a cut and fill actually involved. Some people would prefer to have, you know, two steps of houses or two levels of houses. For them, there is a probability that they might have a cut and fill still, or they might not. And even if they have, it might be a little bit less than what you're seeing here. But yeah, this is what we actually opted for, and this has been our experience. So if you look at it, right, so in terms of images, I've just added few just, you know, for our visual reference. So they bought on this huge, you know, caterpillar, you know, earth mover actually above there. And that guy was so quick. He got the job done in like 4 hours. I mean, you know, it was unbelievable. And you know, they did use quite some amount of, I think, you know, fill sand. And let me tell you, you know, whatever they've cut, you know, if there is any shale, like, you know, small pebbles or rocks which are there, then they would actually remove it out from the site and take it to the dumping area to dump it. But whatever is your fill is fresh sand they're getting in large dump trucks and dumping into your site and filling it. And they also, either they use the earth mover or they would use, you know, other compression equipment to, you know, go ahead and compress the sand layer after layer up until unless it comes out of there. This is a very, very precise way of trying to do it. They measure it, like, you know, for every 10-15 minutes or every half an hour. They measure it at multiple levels because they want to have the whole thing to be in a single level. Now, because my porch and my garage are actually in a different level along with the alfresco, with respect to the rest of the house, in regard to the multiple levels of slab, okay, we will be discussing multiple levels of slab in the upcoming videos. But, you know, because of that, you would see a difference of level in the cuts that, you know, they have gone ahead and done. Now, once the cut is actually, and fill is finished, right from where you're standing on the cut side till the fill end, it's almost all a flat ground. Absolutely flat. And they measure it multiple number of times at multiple reference points to ensure it is a flat ground across. Okay, and then as you can see, you know, this is how a cut would look like. So this is where, you know, they have actually cut close to, you know, 500 to 600 mm. And then as we move forward, and this is, you can see, you know, where you can see cut and fill together. And on the front side of, you know, the home, there was actually a cut. Back side of the property is actually a fill. So Yeah, I mean, this is with respect to cut and fill stage, and the next episode is going to be about site set out and retaining walls. Please do like and subscribe. We would be posting content on a weekly basis, and sometimes couple of times a week, based on as fast as our house construction moves forward on this. Yeah, wish you all the best, and please stay safe.